Styles, the owner of Styles Photographic Studio, is the only character appearing in the play for a long time. But it gives the effect of a drama by making the audience another character. Styles makes his common like dialogue with the audience and makes bodily actions. The scene is a studio with the camera and other equipments, photographs, etc. Styles is a well-dressed, alert young man wearing a white coat and bow tie. He takes a newspaper and starts reading, first about the storm that buffeted Natal and then about Ford Motors in South Africa. The talk slowly slips into the drama proper. Styles gives a graphic description of the visit of Henry Ford Jr. to the car factory in South Africa, where Styles was working in the rough casting section. The black workers in the factory were poorly paid. Now, the visit of the big man from America flickered a hope of increase in the pay packet, but it came to nothing. On Thursday morning, Styles walked into the plant. What? Everything was quiet. No work going on. On the notice board, he read, "Mr. Ford is visiting today." The general foreman, Mr. Bass Bradley, gave instruction, "Listen, boys, don't go to work on the line. There is going to be a general cleaning first." The cleaning started. Big machines with hot water and brushes wiped away the dirt on the floor. In 15 minutes, the factory was as clean as it was newly built. Even the big boss's stood sleeves rolled up. The second step of cleaning started. Boss Bradley came with paint and brushes and made a white line on the floor. The line cut off the rough casting session. Another line was drawn near the eye protection area. Boss Bradley asked Styles, "What was the African language for eye protection area?" The boss could not understand the African words. It was a grand moment for Styles. He was standing while the foreman, plant supervisor, plant manager were bending over the floor. The third step of cleaning, the boss asked them all, about 300 workers, to bathe and make themselves clean. They were all given new uniforms. Bass Bradley called Styles and asked him to translate into Africa whatever he told the workers. Styles translates using angry and obscene words. He tells them that Ford is a big bastard. He is bigger than Bradley and grandmother of them all. When Ford comes, they must slow down the machines and sing songs and smile. They must give him the impression that they are better than the Negroes in his American factory. The boss was pleased at Styles. They all started working and started singing. Then Styles saw through the window three long black galaxies coming up. The general superintendent, line supervisor, general foreman, manager, senior manager, managing director stood like a pack of puppies. Mr. Ford came out, a tall man, 6'6", healthy, full of respect and dignity. Styles mimics the grand strides of Mr. Ford. Mr. Ford didn't talk to any of the bosses. He didn't even look at the plant. When the three cars had gone, they were ordered to double speed on the line to make up for production loss. They had to work harder than ever. Styles had spent 6 years in the Ford company. He was a fool to do it. He read the newspaper again. There is advertisement of the mass murderer Doom, an insecticide, a killer of soil pest. Styles thought of his life. He had been a bloody monkey these 6 years. He had sold his life to a big company. He thought, why couldn't he stop work and turn to some profession? He was a photographer and had made a small side income taking cards at parties, weddings, big occasions, etc. When he told his wife and parents of choosing a profession, they made many objections. His father was the worst opponent. It was a time of Christmas shutdown. He got plenty of time to look around for a studio. His friend Delamney at the funeral parlor told him about a vacant room next door. His friend encouraged him to apply for the room. He did so, and it took some time to get approval. When he got the key, He went to Red location and opened the room. It was not an encouraging sight. The window panes were all broken, big hole in the roof, cobwebs in the corners, but he took up courage. It was a chance that was fatal to miss. Some boys helped him to clean the room. He stood straight in the middle of the room, tall and hefty like Henry Ford. But there was another problem. Cockroaches had made the place thereon before he had come. There were the big paratroopers and invaded the wall, the floor, everywhere. It was then he thought of doom. Straight he went to the chinman's shop and bought two tins. Stiles acted the scene of spraying the room with doom. He gave a dramatic turn to what happened. The cockroaches held a meeting and decided to inoculate themselves against doom. The next morning, he saw many survivors on the floor. Stiles told his friend about the problem and he recommended to get a cat that will eat the cockroaches. He actually gave a cat to Stiles. The next morning, there were only the wings of the cockroaches on the floor. Thus, he started the studio. He made a new history out of it. The simple people who got no place in history books made history through their photos and Stiles gave them. Their children and grandchildren could remember their elders. Stiles shows another photograph of a smiling young man. He wanted to have his photograph standing. That was his dream. Then he took up a piece of paper and smiled and was ready for the snap. Stiles asked him what the paper was. It was a certificate of Standard 6. He studied correspondence course and wrote the exam. He will study again and become a graduate and be a self-made man. Then he talks about his best family card. A family of 27 people came in, father, mother, their children and grandchildren. The son told Stiles that his father wanted to have a family photograph. Stiles looked at the father. He was a living symbol of life, of all it means and does to a man. He sat there half smiling, half serious. Stiles placed them by their age. The height replaced them, arranged and rearranged. Asked them to say the word cheese and to smile. They all smiled and 27 variation of smile all caught in the photograph. A week later, the elder son came back. He said that his father died and cannot see the photograph. Stiles comforted him saying, "We own nothing except ourselves. There is nothing we can leave behind when we die except the memory of ourselves." Stiles tells him that his own father had served in the military and fought for freedom, but nothing remains of him except his photograph. The play takes a new turn here by introducing other characters. Dialogue replace narration. A man with a plastic bag and a hat, it enters. He smiles. Stiles greet him. He has come for a card. Stiles asks him to sit down and takes his name and address. His name is Robert Swellenzima, address 50 Mapia Street. He is staying with a man called Bundu. This man is Swiss Bansi impersonating Robert, who is dead. He wants a photo to send it to his wife Naute. She lives in King Williamstown. He works at Feltex. The pay is not bad. Stiles asks him to relax and smile. His wife would have a smiling photograph. Stiles put a map on the wall and asked Robert to pose with a pipe in his hand. He is now manager of Feltex. Stiles takes one snap and persuades him to take another, if one is lost. Stiles turns the map and it gives a picture of a city. Robert must walk with a newspaper in hand. It doesn't matter that he cannot read. Stiles will take a movie photograph. When he writes a letter to his wife, he can say he is coming to her this Christmas. The picture will show him walking. Robert dictates the letter to his wife. "My troubles are over. Swiss Bansi," in a manner of speaking, "is dead." He continues, "He stayed with a friend called Sola who helped him to find a job. But Port Elizabeth had more people than jobs. After a week, they put a stamp on his passport that he must leave Port Elizabeth in 3 days. Sola looked him to a friend called Bundu who would help him." The next part of the play takes place in Bundu's house. The man introduced himself to Bundu as Sizwe Bansi. Bundu's wife is a domestic and will come home only at the weekend, so the man can stay there for the time. Bansi continues, one night the headman came and found him out in Sola's house. He was taken to the administration office and to the labor's bureau. The white man on the desk had his book. Another white man came with a pink card. It was a record card that carried all his details. They put a stamp on his passbook. Bundu reads the stamp. It directs Bansi to leave Port Elizabeth and report at a Bundu Affairs Commission, King Williamstown. Bansi does not like to leave Port Elizabeth. The law says that he must leave. Bansi says he will burn this book and get a new one. Bundu tells him it is not kidding. If he burns a book and applies for a new one and there is some interval, he will be arrested for having no book and pay 5 rand as fine or 5 days in prison. When the book comes, it goes to the labor bureau to be endorsed with permission to be in this area. The white man at the labor bureau will take into the card and not into his face. Put the card in the machine, it jumps out reading Sizwe Bansi endorsed to King Williamstown. He will be taken to the native commissioner's office with the card around his neck, escort on both sides, and then back to King Williamstown. They will make him pay for the train fare also. Bansi will try to get a job as garden boy, but he won't get it because he knows nothing about seasons and flowers, as will be required by the owner of the garden. If he knows some white man in the place who will give him a letter saying he has got a job for him, he can take it to the native commissioner in King Williamstown. The native commissioner will write a letter to the native commissioner at Port Elizabeth, who will write a letter and send it along with the other letter to the senior officer at the labor bureau, who will put the stamp on his book and send all the document to the administrative office at New Brighton. He can then write an application for the residence permit. If it is so difficult, he will start a little business selling potatoes, but he has no money and won't be able to borrow some money. Even if he gets some money, he will have to obtain hawker's license. It will take the same process. He cannot get that because of the bloody stamp in his book. Bundu asks him to go to the mines recruiting office and dig gold for the white man. Bansi does not want to work in a mine. It is dangerous. He will die under the falling rocks. Bundu asks him whether he is married. He is married and has 4 children. His wife has no job. King Williamstown is a dry place, very small and too many people. That is why he does not want to go back. Bundu has 1 child who stays with his wife's mother. His wife is working in the birth control office. Though he is a native, he had great difficulty in getting a decent job and a 2-room house to live in. Bansi asks why there is so much trouble. Bundu answers with the story of a man called Outa Jacob. When Jacob died, his body was brought to the church. There was a lay preacher at the graveside service. He said, the first man who made a death contract with God was Adam. Wherever man goes, he goes with his faithful companion, death. In his life, Jacob worked for a long time with Bas van der Walt. When the old man died, his son did not like him and sent him out of work. He went from place to place getting some work and losing it. Now he has reached home. The only time we find peace is when they dig a hole for us and press our feet into the earth. Bundu takes Bansi to Sky's place and gives him a treat. He drinks brandy, wine, beer, see many wonderful people. Now he is Mr. Bansi. As they were walking back, talking the drunken talk, Bansi turns to the road that will take them to Sortus. They turn to the right way, come to the Rio Cinema. Bundu says he will take leave and ask Bansi to stay a minute. He wants to have a piss. He goes into the dark and comes back and says that a dead man is lying there. He thought it was a rubbish heap and pissed upon the dead man. Gangsters might have killed him. Bansi says they must report it to the police. Mundu tells him that it is trouble. Bansi has no passport. The police will charge them with murder. Bansi says that they might carry the body home. His passport will give the address. Mundu says it is dangerous to carry a dead body. Mundu disappears into the dark and returns with a passport in his hand. It carries the name Robert Swellinger with photo and identification number and address. Mundu says it will bring trouble to them if they go and inquire at the address. Bansi asks him if he would do the same with him if he finds him dead. Bansi tears away his dress and says he is a man. Mundu asks him to give his passbook. He studied the two books. Bansi exclaims wherever a man goes, the bloody book goes with him. To school, to church, to hospital, to die. Mundu collects Bansi's discarded clothes, Mundu's house. Mundu takes the two books, tears the photographs from either past, paste Robert photos in Swiss books and Swiss into Robert's. Swiss asks what it means. It means that Swiss Bansi is dead. It is a chance to him. Next day, the police will remove the dead body on the roadside. There will be no book to identify him. He will be given a proper burial. Case closed. Tomorrow, Mundu will contact his friend Norman at Feltex and tell him that one Robert Swellingsma seeks work. Bansi must appear in the office. No need of going to the Labor Bureau. The dead chap has a work seeker's permit. Bansi has to pass as Robert. Bansi says he cannot lose his name. Mundu asks him not to worry about his name. As Robert, he will be employed in this town. As Swiss, he will end up in jail. Bansi asks him what he will do with his wife and children. Mundu has the answer. He will explain to her she will accept him or marry him as her husband by the name Robert. He will get this pay on Friday. His children will be happy. Bansi wonders how he could become another man's ghost. Mundu tells him that he was a ghost in front of the Labor Bureau. Now he can become a real ghost. That is what they wanted to make people. Mundu rehearses an imaginary scene where Bansi receives the pay packet in Robert's name. 12 rands 99 cents. The another imaginary scene where Bansi making a deal at a sales office, opening an account and giving his detail as Robert, including Robert's NI number, NI38118863. Mundu acts another scene, calls him Bansi and then tries to arrest him, acting himself as a policeman. Mundu again asks his name. He says Robert. The book is handed over. It is all right. Mundu acts another scene, calls him Bansi and then tries to arrest him, acting himself as a policeman. Mundu again asks his name. He says Robert. The book is handed over. It is all right. Mundu comments. Robert is again alive. The man on whom he pissed in the night. He continues. A name is nothing. What is important is a decent life. The black man is always in trouble. His skin is the trouble. Mundu leaves. Swiss picks up the passbook. He finishes writing his letter to his wife. He is trying to get a lodger's permit. If he get it, she and the children can come and stay there a few days. She must spend the money he is sending carefully. As he finishes the letter, he is revealed in Styles photographic studio. Styles is behind. He asks him, hold Robert, hold like that now. Smile Robert, camera flash and blackout. And that is a summary of this drama.